Right. Good morning. Okay. Let's get started. We're going to talk about Kubernetes and specifically about automating Kubernetes. So we're going way beyond the basics. Although we're going to look a little bit at the basics, but as soon as we get over that, we start looking at the API and how you can actually use that to integrate Kubernetes in your build pipeline and stuff like that. My name is Paul. I'm from the Netherlands. I work for a company called Luminis, and I wrote one book about OSGI. I'm currently writing a book about Java 9 modularity. So you can kind of see the theme about modularity here. So you might be wondering, why is this guy talking about Kubernetes, which is something entirely different. Well, for the past year, most of my time has actually been spent working on an infrastructure platform based on Kubernetes and building tools mostly in Golang around Kubernetes. So, well, that's why. And besides that, I'm still writing this Java 9 book. So that's how I spent most of my days, either writing, building software, or weightlifting. That's my big hobby. But let's get started. So first of all, why should you care about Kubernetes in the first place? Well, we've all heard about Docker, and probably all of you are using Docker. If you're not using Docker, you're probably in the wrong talk. If you use Docker, you know that Docker is mostly about running containers on, well, your own machine, on a single machine. There's some notion of networking there, and they're getting better at it, but it's all fairly limited. And there's definitely not something to actually run containers in a cluster, to take care of failover, to schedule. I think my, there it is. To take care of networking and storage and stuff like that. Although, as I said, they are building more and more stuff into Docker itself to do that kind of things. But if you really want to run containers in production, you need something like Kubernetes to actually make that work. Just having Docker and your Docker command line is just, well, really not enough. We're first going to look a little bit at the basics of Kubernetes, just to get a concept straight that we have to understand before we can start looking at the API and use this API to really start automating things. So if you look at a Kubernetes cluster, it typically at least has the following things. It has a master node, and this master node is kind of in control of the whole cluster. The master node decides where containers get scheduled. It actually does the scheduling, and very importantly, it runs the API server. And that's what we're going to use later on. Then we have a whole number of Kubernetes nodes, and these are your worker nodes. So these are the nodes where your containers will actually run and get started. Then Kubernetes doesn't actually just talk about Docker containers or containers in the first place, but it has an abstraction on top of that, which is called pods. And a pod is kind of an abstraction on top of this container. And we'll get a little bit deeper into that in a moment. So if our worker node just runs a whole bunch of containers, and the master is in control of actually making it all work. Then we also always have a etcd cluster. Etcd is a key value store, and all the information about a cluster is stored in etcd. Etcd is fault tolerant, so you're supposed to have at least three nodes for that, and that's where all the information is stored, and that means you can actually take down parts of the cluster, even the master node, without actually losing any state. And we're going to make use of etcd ourselves later as well. So when we get Kubernetes up and running and we have these components that we just saw, we can actually start thinking about scheduling some containers. Scheduling means actually starting our containers on the cluster. And if you start doing that, the first thing that you need is a replication controller. And this replication controller is an object that runs on the master server. And the replication controller gets configured with the number of replicas that it should start. And we will see some configuration in a minute. When we configure our replication controller that it should have, for example, 5 replicas, it will start 5 containers on 5 different of our worker nodes. Of course, assuming that we have 5 worker nodes. What the replication controller will also do, besides starting those containers, is actually monitoring those containers. if one of my containers gets an out-of-memory exception and just crashes, the replication controller will notice that it doesn't have 5 containers running anymore, but there are just 4, and it will restart my container on one of the other available nodes. So we'll get failover more or less for free by just having this replication controller. So this means that when working with Kubernetes, we are not starting containers on a specific node, but instead we just configure the state that we want. We want to have 5 replicas of a certain container. That's described in a replication controller, and the replication controller makes sure that we will get to that state and that we keep in that state. So the replication controller is a very important concept. Then I already just mentioned that Kubernetes doesn't actually talk about containers directly. We're not starting containers directly, but we're talking about pods. And a pod is just an abstraction on top of a container. Well, first of all, this is important because Kubernetes is not just about Docker containers, but it could also support formats like Rocket, for example, which is an alternative to Docker. This is not actually true yet, because currently, if you look at Kubernetes, well, the only supported format is Docker. But in the future, there will be different formats supported as well. So that's why they have this abstraction. Another reason for this abstraction is that a pod can actually contain multiple containers. So it's not always that a single container is a single pod, or the other way around, but a pod can actually be multiple containers. Well, this is not to have a, let's say, different components deployed together, because the life cycle of the containers in a single pod is completely tied together. They come together and they go together. So if you have, let's say, a microservice deployment, you don't want to put all your stuff in a single pod. That's the wrong way to go to it. But this is useful if, for example, we have a simple web server that we want to start. We could take a simple Nginx container, not modify it, so we just take an out-of-the-box Nginx instance. But for Nginx to be useful, we of course have to pass in our files, our HTML files. And we can put those files in a separate container. Just put those containers together in a pod. And that way, well, they can work together. Those two containers can work together as if it would run on the same physical machine. So they will see the files on the same file system. They will both see each other on localhost, and it kind of works like being on the same physical machine. You don't do that much. In many cases, there's just a single container for a single pod. But this is a interesting feature. Another thing that we get with a pod is networking. Of course, if you run many containers on a single physical machine, where physical machine could just be a instance in the cloud, of course. When we run many containers on the same machine, and all those containers, well, want to use some ports, let's say we have 3 Java applications and they all want to use port 8080, and we would just run that on the ports on the physical machine, well, you run into port conflicts. So you would have to do all kind of port mappings, and that makes things harder to deploy and harder to understand. So wouldn't it be nice if every container that we start gets its own virtual IP address, where it gets access to all the ports available without ever thinking about port conflicts? Well, that's exactly what Kubernetes does. Every time we start a pod, it gets a virtual IP address. That IP address is just there for that single pod. And it gets access to all the ports, so we don't have to even consider port conflicts. And the only thing running on that IP address is whatever that container does, which makes things very easy. But of course, then we also get a new problem, because if you have virtual IP addresses that change every time we restart a container, because that's what happens, how do you actually use those containers? Let's say we have 2 different pods that have to communicate with each other. Well, if their IP addresses keep changing all the time, that's going to be tricky. So to fix that problem, Kubernetes has another concept, which are services. And a service is a kind of a proxy on top of your pods, with a still virtual IP range, but it's fixed. So this IP address doesn't change all the time. So when you want pods to communicate with each other, They don't communicate directly to each other, but they communicate using a service, using this fixed IP address. And the service will just round robin the traffic to the different replicas that we have. So this is very important if you have intercomponent communication. And having this concept of services, it also makes it very easy to have multiple components deployed, which all are part of a bigger application. Maybe you could say microservice architecture, although I really don't like the term microservices. Each component that you have could be deployed as a pod. They each have their own life cycle, so you can deploy them independently of each other. They have their own namespace because they have their own IP address and their own port range. And using services, they can just very easily communicate to each other. So just as an example, we could have a front-end pod, that's our user interface. It uses a number of back-end services or replicas of our back-end service. You see there's multiple pods there, so we have multiple replicas, but we just use the service to proxy to those instances. And we don't really notice it when there are failures because Kubernetes will take care of restarting our pods when there is a failure, and we don't really notice it from the front-end perspective. And maybe this back-end service use a bunch of other services, and they all use this service concept to communicate with each other. This works extremely well. So if you have an architecture like this, Kubernetes makes it very easy to actually deploy that. You don't have to have an architecture like this, but you can. And then the last concept that you have to be familiar with are namespaces. A namespace is kind of an isolated space in Kubernetes, where you have your pods and replication controllers and services, but isolated within that namespace. And that means that you can have, for example, a test environment in a separate namespace and your production environment in a different namespace. And you can have services with the same name, for example, without getting conflicts between those namespaces. So it is very easy to have different environments on the same physical Kubernetes cluster. Right, then we get into deployments. And this is just the first step, because this is obviously not going to be good enough if you actually want to run in production. Because if you download Kubernetes and you look at the tutorials, you see that when you want to create a deployment, well, you have to do that using the kubectl tool, command line tool, where you pass in configuration files to actually, deploy something. And although this tool is getting better and better from a user perspective, I don't really want to type anything when upgrading a production application, because I'm very bad at typing and I mess stuff up. So this is not what we're going to look at the rest of the talk, but I want to show this, to show that it's actually really not enough. What I do want to show is this configuration file that we have to pass in, because that's our first step towards the API. So we use kubectl create and pass in a YAML file. And this YAML file could look like this. This is actually something that would work. So in this YAML file, we define a replication controller. And there's a few important parts here. The first important setting is the number of replicas that we want to have. So in this case, I configure to have 3 replicas, which means that we will start our pod on 3 different machines in our cluster. And more importantly, the replication controller will monitor those pods. And when there is a failure, it will make sure that we restart and always get at 3 replicas. Then at the bottom, there's the actual pod specification, which describes what container I want to start. It describes the actual Docker image that we're talking about. We can configure what ports we want to expose. We can configure storage and a whole bunch of things that we can enable for our pod here. So in this case, we just want to use the Nginx Docker image, and we want to open up port 80. And then finally, we have a whole bunch of metadata, like labels. And those labels are very important when you start looking in the API, because labels are used in Kubernetes to loosely couple the different concepts, like replication controllers and pods, together. So a pod doesn't know what replication controller created that pod. And a replication controller doesn't have a list of pods that it created. But instead, Both the pod and the replication controllers have labels, and those labels will match. And it can just do queries which pods, well, kind of belong to this replication controller. And this is a very loose coupling, but it gives a lot of flexibility when actually working with the API and automating things. So that doesn't have to be totally clear right now, but labels you will see all over the place whenever you do anything with the Kubernetes configuration or the API. So a very quick demo how this actually would look like if you would use kubectl, and after that we start digging into load balancing and using the API. So we have kubectl get pods, and it shouldn't give me anything because it didn't run anything yet. And I have some configuration files here. So I've got a YAML file here, exactly the same thing as we just saw on slides, so I'm not going over it again. But we can use this configuration file to say kubectl create, based on this file, nginx controller. And if we now go back to the get pods, we see that there's one pod running. All right, great. That's good. But it's only one pod. So let's see if we can actually scale this replication controller to have a bunch more replicas. So let's say kubectl scale RC nginx, that's the name of my replication controller. Replicas is 5. And we see we are now in the container creating state, and a few seconds later, most of them should be running. That is how we can scale the number of replicas, the number of pods that we start on our cluster. We can also look at, for example, the IP address that was created. And right here at the top, we see that we have this IP address, and this IP address is our virtual IP address. So this is not an IP address that you would typically use unless you really just want to connect to this specific container, but usually would use the service that we could also create on top of this. So another interesting thing that we can play around here, if you look at these IDs, I'm just going to kill one of them and just see what happens. We've specified that we want to have 5 replicas. That's not going to be changed. But I'm just going to kill this one, kubectl delete pod this ID. And if you now look at the get pods again, we see that there are still 5 pods running, or actually I should say again there are 5 pods running, because Kubernetes noticed the failure. Well, I just deleted it, so it's not really a failure, but I just destroyed it. And because my replication controller is still configured to have 5 replicas, the replication controller notices that, well, there are no 5 replicas anymore. So it will start a new container, so there's a new ID, as you can see. It's a different ID than in the previous list. And that way, we got failover more or less for free. Well, of course, it is a bit stupid if I just delete it myself and wait for it to restart. But the same thing happens when a container crashes for whatever reason. If my Java process goes out of memory, I will get a restarted pod. This works so well that we've had a few production scenarios where our Java application was misconfigured. It didn't have the right memory settings. It would go out of memory every few hours, and we didn't notice it until weeks later. That's not good, but it kind of shows how well this whole mechanism works, because Kubernetes kind of, well, takes care of it. So this is really nice. But as I said, this is by far not good enough to go to production. If I go to production, I don't actually want to use something like kubectl and, well, have the chance of actually making failures typing stuff. But before we start automating this stuff, we have a bigger problem to solve, because I've got my Nginx container running just now, but I can't actually access it from the outside world. Of course, if I have a web application, that's only useful if I can actually access it from the internet. That's kind of the point. So how do we get access to our Nginx containers from the outside world? Well, for that, we have to do some load balancing, or we have to put the load balancer in front of our cluster. So what we want in the end is we want to expose our Kubernetes services to the outside world. And this is not something that automatically works. This is not out of the box just supported. And a few other things that we might want is things like SSL offloading and setting up redirects and stuff like that, things that you would typically use a load balancer for. Well, there is a new feature in Kubernetes. It's in the latest version of Kubernetes, 1.2. That's only a few weeks old. And that feature is called ingress. And ingress is about configuring load balancers. So this is a new concept in the API where you can write a plugin to configure, well, whatever external load balancer that you're using. Unfortunately, it's not completely done yet. It's currently just an alpha version of this whole concept, which means the API is unfinished. And practically speaking, it's just, well, it doesn't really do much yet. There are some demos how it could be working in the future, but it's not working today. Unless you're working on Google Cloud Engine, because they have support for their load balancers, that works great. But if you're not on Google Cloud Engine like myself, then, well, you have to build something yourself for now at least. So in the future, this will probably get easier. We will get ingress support for multiple load balancers. People are working on that, but that's probably at least months away for being available. So how do we solve this today? Well, what we do is we take our HA proxy load balancer and just put that in front of our Kubernetes cluster. So HA proxy doesn't actually run inside Kubernetes, but we put it in front of it on a different machine or set of machines. Then, of course, we want to configure HA proxy dynamically and automatically because we don't want to, well, start changing the configuration file manually every time we deploy a new pod. That kind of defeats the whole purpose. So we have to set up some tooling to actually make this happen automatically. And just to be clear, we use HA proxy, but you could do the same thing with Nginx or Apache or whatever load balancer you have, because well, even with the tools that I will show, that could easily be integrated. So this is kind of the picture where we want to work towards to. We get our HTTPS traffic in HA proxy. This is just running on a separate machine or cluster of machines. We are not in Kubernetes yet. And this HA proxy just looks at the address of the request and will forward the traffic to our Kubernetes service. This Kubernetes service is, of course, just our proxy to our actual pods so that we don't have to take care and don't have to track all our virtual IP addresses of the replicas that we have. So we just forward the traffic to our Kubernetes service, and the Kubernetes service will forward the traffic to the dynamic IP addresses of our pods. This is where we want to end up. In case you're using something like Amazon, like I'm using, you know that Amazon also has the concept of a load balancer, the elastic load balancers. And the elastic load balancers of Amazon are very good at doing the SSL offloading and do that in a very scalable way. So we want to use that. So in our case, we actually have two levels of load balancing. We first get all the traffic into the Amazon load balancers, do the SSL offloading there, forward traffic to our HA proxy, which doesn't really do that much besides just routing to the correct Kubernetes service. And the Kubernetes service will take care of actually getting to our containers. Another thing that you can do if you are in something like Amazon is actually run the whole cluster inside a VPN. That makes the whole security story a lot easier. You don't have to do SSL between all the different components inside the cluster. That's not that necessary at that point. But you can run everything inside the VPN, and the only thing exposed to the outside world is our HA proxy. And that just makes it a lot easier to configure. All right, so conceptually, this is pretty easy. But how do we actually get it to work? Because we still, well, have to configure HA proxy to know about our Kubernetes services. And if you look at HA proxy, and the same is true for something like Nginx, they still use static configuration files. So if you want to add a new backend to HA proxy, and a backend in this case means our Kubernetes service, which knows about our pods, we would have to change this configuration file, reload HA proxy, and well, only after that it will work. And of course, we don't want to do that manually. So we use a little open source tool called Conv.D. And Conv.D is just a tool that watches etcd. Etcd, again, is our key value store that is also used by Kubernetes internally. But we will just write our load balancer configuration in etcd, use Conv.D to watch for changes in etcd. And every time there is a change, we will use a configuration template to regenerate the configuration file for HA proxy, trigger a reload, and everything is automatically working again. That may sound like quite a bit of work, but actually Conv.D is an extremely simple tool. The only thing you have to give it is a template, and this is pretty trivial to set up. All right, so we kind of solved the first part. We can now actually access our applications from the outside world, and now we can start using this whole setup to actually automate things. And we probably want to automate to the point where we can do a git commit and make sure that that git commit actually ends up in production. But of course, within those steps, within those deployments, we don't want to have any downtime. So that's the important step we want to work towards now. And when doing any kind of automation in Kubernetes, you want to start looking in the API. And actually, if you start working with Kubernetes, I think the interesting thing about Kubernetes is actually the API. Out of the box, I would not say that Kubernetes is a, tool that you would use out of the box. Of course you can, and of course most of the tutorials are showing that you're using kubectl, for example. But I think the much more interesting part of Kubernetes is actually the API, so that you can actually make it part of your bigger picture, make it part of your own tool set, and that works very well using this API. Using the API, you can literally access anything in Kubernetes. Kubectl itself is also just using the REST API, so you can get access to everything that you would want to do in Kubernetes. It's just REST, so you can use any kind of language and any kind of tools to work with this API. But to make life a little bit easier, there are a few client libraries. Two of those libraries my team wrote, one for Java and OSGi and one for Go. The reason for that is that when we got started with that, there were actually no good client APIs. There was one for Go, but that dragged in half the internet on dependencies, so that was not very useful. So we wrote some client libraries ourselves. The Java one is completely based on Rx, and the Go version is just, Go, as you would expect from Go. They're both open source, they're partially licensed, and under the Amdatu umbrella project. There's client libraries for different languages as well. I don't know the quality of those, but there's a whole bunch of them. Okay, so automation. When we start automating production deployments specifically, we have to be very careful that we don't have any downtime during deployments. Looking at our own teams, we do production deployments in the middle of the day when there's people actually using the applications. So it's pretty important to actually have zero downtime. And if you want to do zero downtime deployments, you kind of have two options. You can either do a blue-green deployment, or you can do a rolling update. Well, with the rolling update, you say that I have 5 replicas running, and I'm going to upgrade the version of whatever is running one by one. So I'm going to upgrade one of my replicas. When that one is finished, I will upgrade the second one, etc. That works pretty well. But the downside of it is that we will have 2 versions of our application running at the same time during a deployment. And that makes it a little bit more difficult to actually deal with that time window where there's 2 versions running. Because if you upgraded your user interface to use a newly introduced API in your backend, and that backend is only there on a few of your servers, stuff will fail. So it makes it more difficult to deal with this stuff from a coding perspective. That's one of the reasons we like blue-green deployments ourselves, and that's what we will use for this automation. So in a blue-green deployment, we will make sure there's always only one version of our application actively serving load at a given time. And the whole mechanism looks as follows. We get traffic to our application. So HA proxy will receive some requests, and it will just forward them to the replicas that we have running. And we currently only have a single version running of the application. So, well, that all makes sense. Then we start a new deployment, and I just introduced a new component, the deployer, and then we will look into that in a moment. And this deployer deploys a new version, and deploying a new version means that it spins up a new replica set. So we'll get a number of new replicas running our new version of the application. But as you can see, HA proxy doesn't even know about this new version. It doesn't put any load to this new version yet. Because the first thing that we want to do is we want to start health checking this new set of replicas that we have. We want to start health checking if the new version is actually ready to serve load. So all those components running here should support some form of health check. And this can be a very simple health check, like just doing an HTTP call and see if you get a 200 status code. But this could also be much more deep health checks, where you actually check your database connections and all kind of connections to other services. And if you have a dynamic environment, check if everything is started correctly and configured correctly. So you can make this quite complicated. But only after all the replicas that we have report to be healthy, only then we write configuration to confd, reconfigure HA proxy, and from that moment on, we will serve traffic on our new version. And the old version can just disappear. We can just delete that one. This whole mechanism is not Kubernetes specific. The concept of blue-green deployments have been around for a very long time, and this is always a trick using a load balancer. You just instruct your load balancer to use the first version, and at one point you just decide, all my traffic is now going to my new version. This is not a new concept, but it works very well with Kubernetes. So as I said, I just introduced a new component, the deployer, because we had this component that did some health checking and took care of reconfiguring HA proxy at the right time. So what is this whole thing that we call the deployer? This could just be a concept that we talk about. This is not something that is supported inside Kubernetes, but it's just some tooling we write around Kubernetes. I will just show you the concept, how you could actually build that yourself, and I'll also show you an open source tool that kind of does it for you. So this deployer that we have here, the first thing that it does is, it creates a replication controller using Kubernetes API. And the Kubernetes API on its turn will start my pods, and it will create a service for this deployment. And that means that, we just spin up a completely new cluster for our application. Then the deployer will notice that those replicas are started and will start doing health checks. So that could just be an HTTP call on /health. So that's something that we configure in the deployer. We can configure a pod and a port, for example, for doing health checks. And as long as the components actually support those health checks, that will all work out. When all the pods report to be healthy, we will write some new configuration in etcd. As I said, etcd is the key value store used by Kubernetes internally, but we will also use it ourselves to store this load balancer configuration because it's already there anyway, so why not use it? So we will write some data to etcd, and this little tool confd is just watching etcd for new values, and whenever it finds there is a new value in etcd, it will create a new configuration file for HA proxy. And it will give this new configuration file to HA proxy, restart HA proxy in a way that it doesn't drop any connections. You can configure that in HA proxy and most other load balancers. And from that moment on, HA proxy will serve all its load to our new service, which represents our new application version. As you can see, this is this is not very complicated. There's a bunch of stuff going on, but it's not very complicated. There's only a few things you have to do in both the API and the communication with etcd. But it's definitely not rocket science. You can actually write this yourself quite easily. I'm not sure why this is in there again. But as I said, there's also an open source tool that does exactly this, the steps I just described. This is the deployer that we use ourselves. We figured, well, why not open source it? Because this is probably useful for a lot of other people. So this just takes you through the step to do this blue-green deployment. It takes care of this load balancer configuration by just writing to etcd. So if you don't want to use HAProxy, which we support out of the box, you could easily plug in a configuration file for another load balancer. This whole tool is written in Go. Why Go? Well, Kubernetes itself is written in Go, so it seemed to make sense. And it works quite well. Besides that, it was just a lot of fun to actually do something useful in Go. And it's Apache licensed. So if we start using this version of the deployer, we get kind of a deployment descriptor that we can work with. And this is just, well, a few of the settings that we can use there. One of the things that we can enable here is the use health check flag. So that way we can say we actually do want to do those health checks for this component during deployment. Well, why would you want to disable that? Well, let's say you have a container that you do want to make part of your deployment, but it's a third-party component, and it doesn't do any health checks. Well, then this is your way out. We configure the number of replicas. We configure a front-end URL. That's the URL that will be configured in HAProxy. And at the bottom, we have the pod spec, and that's just a pod spec that we get from Kubernetes. So this goes back to the Kubernetes API. That's where we configure our ports and our images and stuff like that. So it's quite simple, and we just pass this in as JSON. Then there's another tool, well, kind of part of this open source project, which is Deployment CTL. And Deployment CTL is a user interface to configure your deployments. You definitely don't have to use this if you use the deployer that we just talked about, because in the end, it's just a REST API. But this just makes it a little bit easier to, well, configure your deployments and redeploy stuff without actually touching any kind of API. So that's quite nice as well. And that's written in a combination of Vertex and Angular too. I've got a bit of a demo for this, and because there's some Docker pushes going on, etc., I actually recorded that, so we don't have to wait for that. The application that we're going to deploy is a simple Go application. And don't worry if you've never seen Go. It's extremely simple because, well, this is the whole thing. What we do here, we create a HTTP server that only responds to slash health. So this application kind of only does a health check, nothing else. And if we invoke this slash health endpoint, the thing that we get back is a struct, just a JSON structure, containing a version of the application, which will be set by the deployer, a message, which is configured as a string at the top, and a Boolean if the component is healthy or not. And I'm kind of cheating a little bit here, because the Boolean is just set as a, well, fixed Boolean value right there in the top. But that will give me the possibility to actually do a unhealthy deployment later on. So that's why we start playing with that. All right, so let's start looking at this. We will first check if there's any deployments currently. So we'll see kubectl again to actually see what's happening under the hood. There's no pods running. And the front-end URL that we will be looking at doesn't respond at the moment, which is good because it means there's nothing deployed yet. This is deployment CTL, the user interface that I just talked about. We can configure the front-end URL, the number of replicas, and, well, of course, the Docker container that we want to use. You get completion on a number of things there. We can set all kind of resource limits, which are also important in Kubernetes, so that you can, well, run as much as possible on the same physical hardware. We can configure ports, so we have our health check port that we will look at. And then we just click deploy, we see the logs. And in this case, it's configured in a way that it will actually sleep for 20 seconds before actually reloading the configuration in HAProxy. We now have our pod running, so we see that we have a replica, and now we can just wait for those 20 seconds, or actually, well, the waiting time is cut out of the movie. And whenever it's completed, we can look at the URL, and we see that we have the first version now deployed, just using this user interface. Okay, that was good, but let's try a second version. So we change the message of the application. We will do a build of this image and actually push it to the Docker registry. And we will simply click on deploy again. We see that the version here at the top is automatically generated. So that's why we just had version 1 and we will now see version 2. It's spinning up our new version, but again, what we see now is that there's two versions running next to each other, but our front end still gives us version 1. Why? The load balancer is still waiting for the health checks, etc. to happen, and it didn't switch versions yet. After 20 seconds, because it's configured like that, it does. And if we go to the curl again, we see that it now gives version 2. And the old version of the pod will be cleaned up by now. This was another healthy deployment. Now let's try what happens if we do an unhealthy deployment. I messed up, made a coding mistake or a configuration mistake, and I pushed something to production which doesn't actually work. Well, luckily we have our health checks, because what's happening now is that it will go through the same steps. It will spin up our pods. If we go to kubectl, we'll actually see both versions running. So we have pods for both of them. But in contrast to the previous deployment, it will time out. It will see, well, this health check is never going to get healthy. So deployment failed, and it will actually roll back this deployment, and we will just stay at the old version. The new version is just deleted. The nice thing about this whole mechanism is that even if you have massive amounts of concurrent requests coming into your application, they will not actually notice any downtime during those deployments. We are actually testing this whole mechanism using Gatling, literally just firing as many requests as possible to a version, and we will see no dropped requests. So that means that our users don't actually know or care if you do a production live update. If it fails, they will just stay at the old version. No harm done. If it succeeds, we will go to the new version. Then there's, of course, one thing that can go wrong. If our health checks actually succeed, because we have bad health checks, but the application crashes as soon as we put actual load on it, well, then we did write some really crappy health checks to begin with. But that would be a problem, because then, well, everything will just collapse after the deployment is finished. And then you would just have to roll back manually whenever you finish, when you find that problem. But that doesn't typically happen a lot. All right, so that's what we can get with the Kubernetes API and using, if you want to, some open source tools around that. And this also makes it very easy to actually completely integrate this in your build pipeline. Just now I've been using the user interface to actually start a deployment, but we could also completely automate that and just look at a commit to master, for example. Our build server will build a new Docker image. We'll push it to Docker Hub or whatever other Docker registry that you're using. Docker Hub supports webhooks, so we can just invoke a webhook on the deployer. The deployer knows which deployment that belongs to. It will start a new deployment as we've just seen, and we have a completely automated deployment to potentially production. And that seems to work quite well. All right, completely different topic. Scaling. What we have already seen in Kubernetes just now when I was starting to play with kubectl is that kubectl has this scale command. And with this scale command, we can very easily scale the number of replicas within the cluster that we have. Well, that's very great, but in practice, we don't just need to scale the number of pods, but we probably also want to scale the number of nodes. And in some cases, you want to scale up, But maybe at nighttime, we actually want to save costs to Amazon and scale down the application as well. And that doesn't just mean that we can scale the number of pods, because even if, well, one of our nodes is not doing anything, we would still pay to Amazon. So we actually want to scale the number of machines that we're using as well. And that makes it a little bit more complicated, because let's say that we are actually running on Amazon or some other cloud provider. Yeah, Kubernetes doesn't really know about that. So it doesn't have the constructs within Kubernetes to take care of this machine level scaling. It just takes care of the scaling within the cluster. And we have to take care of both. Again, using the API, we can quite easily do that. To scale up, it's very easy. We use the Amazon API. Let's assume we're using Amazon. There's APIs for the other cloud providers as well, of course. And for Amazon, we can use a scaling group to configure the number of Kubernetes worker nodes that should be active. And we just use cloud init or other kind of scripts that whenever a new machine is started within the scaling group, it initializes itself as a Kubernetes node, will register itself to the master, and it's good to go, serve load. From that point on, we can just scale up the number of replicas that we have, and they will probably start on this newly started machine. So that's easy. Scaling down is a little bit more work, because then we have to make sure that we don't actually destroy a running application by turning off its machine. So the first thing that we do there is actually set a node to unschedulable. That means in Kubernetes terms that it will not actively remove anything that runs on this server from that server, but it will not start any new containers on this node. The next step is to drain the node. And that means that we really relocate the running pods to different nodes, assuming that we have enough capacity. And only when this node is not running any of our containers anymore, we actually remove the node from Kubernetes. So for Kubernetes, it doesn't exist anymore. And we use the Amazon API to actually, shut down the machine and stop paying for it. Again, using those APIs, you can easily do that. But we have another open source tool for this, and that gives you a CLI to actually go through those steps. And probably the most interesting part of this is that there is a way to configure schedules. So just using this JSON format, we can configure that at, in this case, 9 in the evening, we'll switch to half of our capacity. And we'll both configure the number of replicas for the applications that we have, but also the desired capacity of our Amazon cluster. Using this schedule, it will automatically scale down in the evening, and probably you'll have another schedule that actually scales up again in the morning, and that way you can have a scalable Kubernetes cluster and pay as little as money as possible to something like Amazon. This also works quite well, although this whole concept is not supported in Kubernetes, and that's kind of the point. Using this API, you can kind of make Kubernetes do whatever you want. So I'm actually going to skip this. One more point to make. This is a question that many people ask. And they will ask, this is all great, but what about my database? Because my database obviously has state. And how do you run something like that in a dynamic environment like Kubernetes? Because Kubernetes, as we've seen so far, is kind of stateless. It just restarts containers wherever it wants, and it doesn't quite work. My answer to that is currently you don't. Don't run data stores in Kubernetes. Technically you can, and you will definitely find tutorials on the internet to do so for pretty much every data store out there, but you're making your own life very difficult. Kubernetes does have the concept of persistent storage. That all works, but to actually configure that correctly and tune that correctly to run a highly available data store like Mongo or MySQL or whatever, that's actually not very easy. And that's mostly because data stores don't really support this whole concept of a dynamic environment like this. They don't like auto-scaling and things like that. So just make your own life easy. Don't run your data stores in Kubernetes. Just run them as you previously did on whatever server that you want, and let your Kubernetes services use those data stores. All right. As I said, my team is working on a Kubernetes-based platform with monitoring and logging and all that kind of good stuff, stuff that you would definitely need. There's a lot of good tools for that. We just use all kind of open source tools to do things like monitoring. There's Grafana, for example. So definitely look outside just the scope of Kubernetes when you're looking at this kind of stuff. And, well, that's what we do. I'm out of time. Thank you for your time. If there are any questions, you have 1 minute left, and after that, just find me in the hallways. Thank you. Any question? Go ahead. So the question is, why not use a Kubernetes service instead of my HAProxy load balancer? That's a good question, because we kind of have two levels of load balancing now. A Kubernetes service, however, is still on a virtual IP address. You can expose it to an actual port on a host machine, but that will, well, kind of make the failover story a little bit more brittle, because what if you restart a machine on Amazon and it gets a new IP address, for example, because that's dynamic as well. That's why we put HAProxy in front of it, so we get a more reliable, maybe not the right term, but a more static configuration that forwards stuff to Kubernetes. That's the reason for that. Any other questions? Very good question again, and this always comes up. How do you take care of scheme changes for your database when you do a blue-green deployment? As I said, that's a very good question, and that's not a problem that's easy to solve. If you have especially a relational database and you have this kind of blue-green deployments, no matter if you're using Kubernetes or not, scheme changes are going to be difficult. So you either have to be very sure that scheme changes are always backwards compatible so that your new scheme also works for your old scheme. Then you can first do the database upgrade and then do the application upgrade. That's a possibility. You can do hot swapping of databases. I know some people who actually boot up a completely new database cluster with a new scheme and just roll over that that whole database instance. That's an option. If you have a schemeless database like Mongo, you kind of move it to your code level, because of course there's a scheme somewhere in your system, but that makes it a little bit easier to just take care of that from your code. But it's always a difficult question. It's an unsolved problem. I think I'm now really out of time, so if there's any more questions, just come forward and ask me. Thank you very much.